our service today of Holy Communion. And as you came in today, we're going to be given a piece of Lego. When Liz comes to bring us God's word out and explore God's message for us, that will become clear as to why we've been given that. Let's just pray. I'll just pray for us as we start our worship this morning. Lord Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can meet freely in your presence without fear. We can be open to your peace and your joy, your manifold love for us. We can come together and declare your kingdom promises over our lives, Lord, and over Brian Knowles and Clay Hanger, and say, Lord, that we are ready and willing to serve you. So, Lord, inspire us by your spirit today as we worship you and seek to do that in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Going to sing together as we start worship. So, if you're comfortable there, but let's stand together.
Faithful and cheerful every day.
Amen. Back to take a seat, and Mel's going to lead us in the short activity now.
So,
I'm just when people go up to our activities now, the rest of us are sharing a form of confession, so let's just pause and be mindful for God's wonderful forgiveness and how we can each receive that once again today and be made completely new and from anything over the past week that we feel need to be made new from. The grace of God has dawned upon the world with healing for all. Let us come to him in sorrow for our sins, seeking healing and salvation. Let us return to the Lord our God and say to him, let's pray together. Father, we have sinned against heaven and against you. We are not worthy to be called your children. We turn to you again. Have mercy on us. Bring us back to yourself as those who once were dead, but now have life through Christ our Lord. Amen. So may the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. With deep gratitude in our hearts, we are going into a time of sun worship. So feel free to stand and sit, and however you want to express your thanks and praise to the Lord, and enter in to his heavenly presence.
Yeah.
wonderful, Lord. We can never get to the end of expressing how great you are. And so we pray, Lord, that we'll be open to you as we come to explore your readings to us today. Amen. I'd like to take a seat. Our first reading, Andrew's going to call for us.
The reading is taken from Colossians chapter 1, verse 1 to 14. And if you'd like to follow, you can find it on page 1182. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to God's holy people in Colossae, the faithful brothers and sisters in Christ. Grace and peace be to you from God our Father. We always thank God for the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ when we pray for you, because we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of your love you have for all God's people, the faith and love that spring from the hope stored up for you in heaven, and about which you have already heard in the true message of the gospel that has come to you. In the same way, the gospel is bearing fruit and growing throughout the whole world, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and truly understood God's grace. You learned it from Ephesus, our dear fellow servant, who is a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf, and who also told us of your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of his will, through all wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord, and please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power, according to his might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father who qualified you to share in the inheritance of his holy people in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption for the forgiveness of sins. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
If you'd like to stand for the reading of the gospel, if you're comfortably able, Dennis is going to bring that to us now.
On page 1081. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John chapter 13, beginning to read at verse 31.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When he was gone, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself, and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now. Where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. And by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." Simon Peter asked him, "Lord, where are you going?" Jesus replied, "Where I am going, you cannot follow now, but you will follow later." Peter asked, "Lord, why can't I follow you now? I lay my life down for you." Then Jesus answered, "Will you really lay down your life for me? Very truly I tell you, before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, God.
Please do be seated. And let's pray together. Lord Jesus, as I look round here and I see each person, Lord, it fills my heart with praise that every person here matters to you. Every person here is important. We can't do without any single person in this room. So I pray today, Lord Jesus, you will speak to us through your word, that you will illuminate what you want to say to us, and that your Holy Spirit may just embrace us with your love today. Thank you that you're with us, Lord. Amen. Amen. Last week, Gail talked to us about teams. Do you remember?
Yes,
they were there. Yes, they were there. What makes a good team, she talked about. And she talked as well about sharing a common purpose, reaching the world, sharing the love of Jesus, going out there, having deep conversations, she talked about. So today I'm going to continue with this theme as part of the Jesus-shaped people. But I'm going to delve a little bit deeper as we look at two Bible passages that we've just heard from John and from Paul in Colossians. First of all, I'm going to have a look at Jesus' relationship with his team. Yeah, he had a team. And then at the job spec, sign of the word, isn't it? But that's what, if you're getting a job, you have to know what you're going for. What's the team being asked to do? And then finally, as Jesus' continuing team, what are we going to be asked to do? How do we do the job of being salt and light in the world? Do you know, I'm fascinated by Jesus' relationship with his disciples and his followers. You know, Gail has to put up an awful lot with us, I think. She's so patient, isn't she, with us? But Jesus had to put up with a whole bunch of unruly, arguing, dense, impulsive, and occasionally violent people. If you don't know about that, just read up about Peter, what he got up to. Many of the characteristics that you can find in the church today, regretfully. And then other characters in the Bible who were part of the wider team. Look at Martha, busy with the practical stuff, and her sister Mary, focused on worship and adoration, ignoring the dust on the shelves. And then the inner team, there's Peter, charging ahead, filled with rash enthusiasm, without any thought of the consequences, and a bit too handy with a sword. And John, steady, loyal, and passionate, but he still fell asleep when he should have been keeping watch. James, fanatical. Matthew, humble. Philip, inquisitive. Bartholomew, composed. Andrew, open-minded. Jude, intense. James, son of Alphaeus, quiet. And Judas, a traitor. But God chose each one of them for a purpose, to fan the flames of the gospel that would spread across the face of the earth and to continue burn bright through the centuries to follow to today. Now let me ask you this morning, do you recognise yourself? Do you? In any of those followers? Because let me tell you this, we would be exactly the people that Jesus would choose. How do you feel about that? But hang on, wait a minute. We are the people that Jesus has chosen. Are you a Peter or a Paul or a Mary or a Martha? Whichever you are, you're chosen by God. And when Jesus speaks to his disciples, you can hear through his words how much he values them. Dear, dear children, he calls them. And Paul does the same in our Bible reading in Colossians. He encourages his readers in Colossae. He praises their faithfulness. He asks God to bless them and give them peace. See, part of being a leader is to be an encourager and to recognise the gifts of the people in your team. So Paul prays for them and he thanks God for them. He's so glad that they trust the Lord and love his people. It's wonderful for a leader to know that your people love Jesus. And he's thrilled that they know that they've been saved and going to heaven. He's thrilled to know that every person in his team is going to heaven. Wow, what a wonderful example we see in Jesus and Paul of how to engage with those for whom we have responsibility. And we all have responsibilities, whether in church, in our jobs, or in our families. So moving on, Jesus has his team, and now he sits them down and he explains to them the job spec. What's he asking them to do? What's their purpose? Why do they get up in the morning? So I wonder, what do you think are the big questions people ask in life? What are the big questions that people ask in life? When I looked it up, these questions came up. These are the big questions in life. Who am I? Why am I here? How should I live? Where am I going? Have you ever asked those questions? And Jesus has the answer. Jesus has the answer to all those questions. Last week, Gail talked to us about our common purpose to reach the world, sharing Jesus. In our Bible passage in John, Jesus tells us a bit more. He gives a new commandment. He outlines the job, in other words, and this is the job. Love one another just as much as I love you. You know, for a long time in my prayers, I've been praying, help me, Lord, to love others as much as I love myself. But you know, recently I thought to myself, that's not enough. I often don't love myself very much, actually. I don't know about you. I get frustrated when I get things wrong. I'm not always as compassionate and caring as I'd like to be. But if I could, in some small measure, love others as Jesus loves me, now that would be something else, wouldn't it? And that's how I'm praying now. I'm working on it. And Jesus was saying something revolutionary. To love others as much as he loved. To love others as much as he loved others. When you think what Jesus did on the cross for us, that really is something else. And why? Because you see, such love will not only bring unbelievers to Christ, it will keep believers strong and united in a world hostile to God. It keeps us strong and united in knowing that God loves us and how much he loves us because of what he did on the cross. So here's a question. Do people see petty bickering or jealousy or division in the church? Or do they know that we're Christ's followers by our love and acceptance of one another? And the thing is, you see, we can't share Jesus unless we love one another. It's a really big put-off unless we're demonstrating that love. And love is more than simply warm feelings. It's a kind of attitude. It's something you decide to do. It's an attitude that reveals itself in action. Helping when it's not convenient. Giving when it hurts. Devoting energy to others' welfare rather than our own. Absorbing hurts from others without complaining or fighting back. That kind of loving is hard to do. And that's why people notice when we do it. And they will sense that we're empowered by something more than being a do-gooder. There are lots of people who do good. But the spiritual power, huge spiritual power in our love and our caring. And I've often thought, what makes us distinctive as Christians? And it isn't just doing good, because millions of people are doing good daily, aren't they? Millions of people each day are caring. But no, it's loving one another, loving others in God's power through His Holy Spirit. So how can we do it? How do we do this? It's not easy, is it? How can we be a dedicated team? Team St. James. How can we fulfil God's purpose for our lives? How can we fulfil our destiny? How can we answer those questions? Those big questions. Questions that will probably be in the hearts and minds of people we encounter every day. People as we walk the dog, people as we walk, go to the shops, people as we sit down and have a meal in Smithy's Forge or in Cardamom Spice or whatever it's called these days. They may not articulate them, but deep down, that is what people are searching for. Security in a chaotic world, certainty in a world of changing and vacillating opinions, hope for now and for the future. Who am I? Why am I here? How should I live? Where am I going? How can we love one another? And we do find answers in both our Bible passages today. Who am I? Paul says in Colossians 1 verse 2. We're God's people. We're children of God. That's the answer. Graham was saying just last Monday that God took a dry old rock and clothed it with water, seas, plants and animals. God's power is infinite. Don't ever doubt that. God's power is everlasting and we are His children, His precious creation. Why are we here? Why are we here? Isn't that just what we're looking at, Jesus-shaped people at the moment? We have a purpose to bring God's rule of peace and love and salvation into a broken world. And it is a broken world, isn't it? But we have a purpose. But it didn't all end when Jesus died, was resurrected and ascended. It all began then. That's when it actually began. Over to you, Jesus said. Love one another, Jesus said. My kingdom come, Jesus said. Next question, how should I live? You know the answer. Love one another. Our Colossians passage goes further. Live by pleasing God, honouring Him, doing good, being kind, getting to know God better. It's not just for our information, the Bible. It's for our transformation. Peter says, Master, where are you going? Jesus replied, you can't go with me, but you will follow later. Paul says, you're looking forward to the joys of heaven. There's the answer. That's where he's ultimately going. Life with God in His eternal kingdom. We, God's people, we have the words of eternal life. How can we not share them with others? Well, you might say, that's okay for St. Peter and St. Paul. That's okay for St. James and St. Matthew. But I haven't got it in me. I'm too old. I'm too young. I'm too busy. I'm too tired. I'm too stressed. I think the real answer lies with Jesus. Why is that? And you know why? I think it's because Jesus knows us. Have you ever thought about that? How much Jesus knows each one of you? He knew Peter. Peter rashly proclaims, "I'm ready to die for you." Oh, he was always one for the big gesture, wasn't he, Peter? But, Jesus knows. "Die for me," he says. "Die for me." No. 3 times before the cock crows tomorrow morning, you'll deny that you even know me. See, Jesus knows. He knows what we've done. He knows what we're going to do tomorrow. He knows when we stumble and when we fall. He knows us. He knew Judas would betray him, you know. Jesus knows each of us, our weaknesses, our failings, our lack of faith, our fears. He knows what we're going to do that will hurt him. He knows our reticence to do the task he's laid before us. But he still loves us unconditionally and forgives us when we get things wrong and go to him in repentance. Jesus knows our hearts. Peter understood this, and despite his shortcomings, he grew into his purpose. His life ended triumphantly because he never let go of his faith in the one who loved him. Judas couldn't understand this, and his life ended in tragedy. Let me tell you the story of the cracked pots. Does anyone know the story of the cracked pots? You do, Angela. Right. There was a water bearer in India, and she had 2 large pots. Can you imagine? One hung on each end of a pole, two pots. But one of the pots had a crack in it, while the other pot was perfect and always delivered a full portion of water at the end of a long walk from the stream to the master's house. For 2 years, this went on daily, with the bearer delivering only 1.5 pots of water. The perfect pot was full of its accomplishments, but the poor, cracked pot was ashamed of its own imperfections and miserable that it was only able to accomplish half of what it had been made to do. After 2 years of what it perceived to be a bitter failure, it said to the water bearer, "I'm ashamed of myself and want to apologise to you. Because of my flaws, you have to do all this work and you don't get full value from your efforts." The water bearer replied, "Did you notice that there are flowers only on your side of the path? That's because I've always known about your flaw, and so I planted seeds on your side of the path. And every day when you walk back from the stream, you've watered them. Because of you, everyone has enjoyed the beauty of the flowers." Now, don't take this personally, but we're all cracked pots one way or another, aren't we? Please say yes. But we are, aren't we? But Jesus knows this. He knows us. And he still uses us for his purposes. And that's how we do it, really. That's how we do it. That's how we have this common purpose. Day by day, we grasp onto Jesus, don't we? Not in our own strength, but in his. When we fail, as we will, we can turn to the one who knows us. When we succeed, as we will, we can recognise and celebrate God's hand on our life. We can lean on God and step out in faith together as a team. Team St. James. So have you still got your Lego bricks? Has everybody got your Lego brick? Yeah? Jolly good. Right, I want you to hold them in your hands, okay? Yeah, that's just getting hands. Now, I want you to imagine that God made that brick and gave it to you to build something amazing, right? But look, it's only one brick. It's only one brick. Now imagine what you could make if you shared your bricks. And if all the churches shared their bricks. Now Lego's really expensive, isn't it? Has anybody been to Legoland? Have you seen some of the amazing things that are built at Legoland? The Eiffel Tower, complete villages, the Death Star, the Millennium Falcon, Darth Vader. Amazing things built out of Lego. But what can we build for God? I would like you just to take a moment to hold that Lego piece in your hand and dream big things for God. Perhaps you might want to say to him, "Here I am, Lord. Take me, use me. I'm a cracked pot, but use me to do amazing things." And afterwards, perhaps when you have some coffee, you might want to share your bricks with the children and they can build something amazing too, because they're all bricks in God's kingdom. So let's just take a few moments of silence and then I'll close with a prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you that we are all bricks in your team, that you use us to build your kingdom. And Lord, please take us as we are and do great things with us, we pray. Amen.
Shared and ponder that in our hearts, and just encourage us now to declare our faith together. So if you're comfortably able, let's stand in God's presence. We share together as God's family, remembering everything that we believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I'd like to take a seat, and Anne is going to lead us in our prayer.
Let us pray. Almighty God, your mother and father to us all, look upon your planet Earth divided. Help us to know that we are all your children, that all nations belong to one great family, and that all of our religions relate to you. Multiply our prayers in every land until the whole earth becomes your congregation, united in your love. Sustain our vision of a beautiful future and give us strength to work increasingly to make that vision real. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings you have bestowed on our lives. You have provided us with more than we could ever have imagined. You have surrounded us with people who look out for us. You have given us family and friends who bless us every day with kind words and actions. Dear Lord, we ask that you bless us with the ability to view each other's strengths and weaknesses. Lord, show us the gifts we each have and guide us in using them to bring our teams together. We particularly pray for the various teams at St. James Church, the senior management team, the PCC, the pastoral team, the child's ministry team, the choir and the music groups, the Graveside and Truth groups, the food bank team, places of worship team, open the book team, and any other teams and groups that St James Church has. Amen. God of all goodness, look with mercy on all who are suffering any kind of infirmity, sickness, injury or bereavement, that they may be comforted. Let your hand of healing and protection be upon them. When they are fearful, ease their anxieties and fears. When they are afraid, give them strength and courage. Amen.
Amen.
Gracious Father, we thank you for the opportunity to meet together today. As we leave this place, surround us with your love. May we see your beauty, feel your love, know your wisdom and experience your power. May we find the comfort we desire in you and the strength we need in your name. May your presence be with us every hour of the day. May your love be the passion in our hearts. May your joy be our strength when times are hard. May your presence be the peace that overflows in our lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of our soul.
Prayer to share together in them as well. Let's say some together. Lord God, pour out your Spirit upon your people and grant us a new vision of your glory, a new experience of your power, a new faithfulness to your word, and a new discovery of your purpose for the church today. Let your kingdom come on earth as in heaven. Amen. Sharing Jesus' peace now, and so in a moment we'll offer a greeting to each other as we would like to. So remember this day that the Lord Jesus has brought us peace with our Heavenly Father God and made it possible for us to live in true unity and harmony with one another as brothers and sisters. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And
show a sign of Jesus' peace.
Thank you.
this time of communion, Lord, take us closer and deeper with you. Amen. But to take your seats. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son Jesus Christ to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you, with saints and angels praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of paramount, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, and as we obey his commands, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine yet poured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was ended, again he praised you, and he gave it to them, and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
So Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven, through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Being made one by the power of the Holy Spirit, as Jesus our Saviour has taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Though we are many, we are one body.
Because we are one
bread. Draw near with faith.
Maker of the stars above.
as your family and experience your spirit, that we might be moulded more and more into your likeness and be able to live out your common purposes for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I have some points of knowledge to share for today. So I published the bands of knowledge between General Craig Morris and Rebecca Andor, both of this parish, and this is now for the third time of asking. If anyone knows any reason as to why these persons may not legally marry, you are to declare it. Let's just pray a moment before Dan and Rebecca. Lord Jesus, we thank you that Dan and Becky desire to be married in your sight, and we pray that they will be bound together in your love this day and every day leading up to the day of their wedding, and Lord, after that too, that they would experience your goodness in their lives. Amen. And as regards to the fun day, we'll have a plan coming out on Tuesday of what's happening outside. Again, if wet weather does take place, then we'll have a wet weather plan for inside. So please just spread the word, everyone to come who's not tied up doing anything else next Saturday. It would be really great to see you all as we join together. And another thing to show is we've got Limitless coming up, which is all finalised in terms of the week that many of us are going on, 22 of us are going on that week. But if anyone would like to go for the day, then you might just about still be able to book a ticket. I know the tickets were running low for the day passes. So if you do want to go for the day, speak to me afterwards and we can get that sorted for you. And then next Sunday night we have a memorial service as well. So for anyone who's lost a loved one over the past 3 months period, there's a chance to come to church and to acknowledge that loss. We do send direct invites out to families and to individuals next to the kin. But if there's anyone you want to come remember on that night and receive prayer ministry for your loss, they might have died very recently or they might have died a long while ago, but you feel that you still need healing for that and God to minister to you for that bereavement, so come along next Sunday night if that is you. And as we come towards the close of our service, we have a final prayer of blessing for us all. So my God, who clothes the lilies and feeds the birds of the sky, who leads lambs to pasture and deer to water, who multiplies loaves and fishes and changes the water into wine, lead us, feed us, multiply us and change us to reflect the glory of our Creator now and through all eternity, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be with us now and remain with you always. Amen. Does anyone from our children and people want to share what they've been doing over the hall? It would be really great to hear, just briefly, before we finish. Does anyone want to come and help gather and share together what you've enjoyed doing? That would be lovely. You come in, Musa? Yeah? Thanks, Musa.
So we looked at what it was to be a disciple today in the teaching in the context of that verse where Jesus tells us to love one another. And we looked at the word disciple, and we looked at each letter in the word, and we looked at words that could describe a disciple that life starts with that letter. So I was wondering if anyone could just help me to give me a letter, a word which starts with the letter L, which describes a disciple.
Love.
Love, very good, excellent. And how about P? There were lots of them. Not piano, no. Peace, praise, passion, these are all the type of words. And so we went through this, and I can put this up on the board at the back, and then you can see that.
But it sounds like it was really important. We've had fun together, so it's good to know. Brilliant. And so go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ.